My name is Kim McLarin. I'm your moderator. I'm just overwhelmed and honored to have been asked by Coolidge Corner. I want to thank you for inviting me. Let me just say that it is my honor to be here. I'm going to introduce our guests, and we're going to get straight into the conversation because we have a lot to talk about, both with the film in particular and, of course, the great James Baldwin in general. I think it's thrilling that he is being reintroduced to a new generation, and we're going to jump right in and have this conversation. Just to reintroduce the panelists, to my immediate right, we have Renee Graham, who is an associate editor and columnist for the Boston Globe, our local paper. Your biography is here, so I won't extend it, all of it. David Leeming, who, of course, is James Baldwin's biographer. I'm rereading his biography right now. It's a brilliant piece of work. I highly recommend it to you, and was his formal personal secretary. And then Quentin Miller, who's a professor and chair of English at Suffolk University and a Baldwin scholar. I can't believe we haven't met. How did that happen? And we're literally right next door, too, because I teach at Emerson College, so that's weird. Concentric circles. Anyway, so let's jump right in. I think we should start with, I don't know if you've all seen the film before today. Have you? You had not, David? Oh, so let's maybe start with your immediate reaction to it. I mean, you, of course, knew James Baldwin personally and very well. So what's your gut reaction?
My immediate reaction is how thrilled he would have been by this film. He always wanted to make films, but he wasn't very good at it because there were too many words in the film scripts that he came up with. He tried to say too many things, leaving aside what the camera might do. And if he could see this film, he would be absolutely thrilled. He'd be thrilled to know that that little manuscript, Remember This House, was a perfect vehicle for the film. He would have given anything to have written. And he didn't know that he had a film right there before him.
Powerful. Yeah. He was of course, a great film scholar and a film critic. Devil Finds Work, an incredible book. Renee, I don't know if you've seen it before.
Yeah, I watched it on Friday.
Okay, so what's your immediate reaction?
My immediate reaction really was, you know, not a week goes by and I spend way too much time on Twitter and someone is forever quoting James Baldwin. You know, it's always coming up. And suddenly, you know, there he was in the flesh, you know, to see it coming out of his mouth, to see the articulation, to see the ideas, to see the fire and the passion. And I think that's what really came through to me initially. And of course, all the other obvious things that, you know, a lot of these clips are 50 years old and painfully relevant. You know, I grew up reading James Baldwin, and because my parents were big fans of James Baldwin, and my father watched the Dick Cavett Show, so I'm sure he saw that episode when James Baldwin was in. And as we're sitting here in 2017, and this month being the 15th anniversary of my father's death, everything James Baldwin said in that clip is still completely relevant. And I think in a lot of ways that's incredibly tragic that, you know, it's like we didn't listen and we're still not listening.
That clip is a perfect, the New York Times review was great where he says, he talks about that moment of watching mediocrity condescend to genius with that guy from Yale who nobody's, I'm sorry, but if you know who he is, but I don't know who he is. But and then James Baldwin just searingly puts him in his place. And it is painful because it is so brilliant and still so relevant. So Quentin, what's your first reaction?
I did see it as well last Friday, and I was just kind of impressed by the way the film moves back and forth across space and time. I think a lot of Baldwin's late works did the same thing. From the essay, No Name in the Street On, I don't know if you're familiar with that, published in 1972. From that moment, I think that Baldwin's vision was expansive. I mean, it was always expansive, but I think that he was really kind of doing interesting things with the structure of his essays in which time and space didn't really confine them. And I think that the film is a great homage to that as it moves back and forth between his time and our time, and doesn't condescend to kind of, you know, put things in a neat logical order for us, but rather to make us do some of that work to make the connections. And I think, again, I think Baldwin would have loved it for that reason and many others.
Yeah, I mean, David, I don't know, maybe you can just tell us briefly, he was not able to complete the script because he became ill, and just maybe fill us in on this, and right, we can talk a little bit about how Raoul Peck, of course, came to do this film.
I worked for Baldwin for several years in the 60s and sorted his manuscripts. And then later in the late 80s, when he was very ill in Saint Paul de Vence, he asked me to come to visit and to sort the papers that were there. And one of the files I came across, or one of a group of very miscellaneous papers, was listed under Remember This House. And I put those papers together into some sort of a form, and that would seem to be the form that was used for this film. He was at the end of his life. He was determined that he was going to finish this book, but it was very obvious to everyone around him that that wasn't going to happen. But I remember talking with him for a good hour and a half about Remember This House. And his original idea was that it should be a book in which the lives of Medgar Evers, Malcolm X, and Martin Luther King should be told through the mouths of their children. And he said to me, in fact, would you be willing, since you're my, by then he had accepted me as his biographer, he said, would you go back to the States and would you interview the children of these three figures? Well, it was evident that he wasn't going to be able to write the book, so I said yes, of course, but knowing that that wouldn't be possible. But in effect, what happens in this film is that although the children aren't specifically interviewed, one gets the sense that Baldwin's wish came true, because the editor of the film obviously did take into account the children of the three, with the idea that the house could only be remembered if it was the children who remembered it. That is, the people who came afterwards. And an interesting thing about the manuscript was that if you looked at it, if you were looking at it today, you would see that on his title page, he has /member. So he's talking not only about remembering in the usual sense that we use that word, he's talking about that, but he's also talking about the very necessary process by which the house can be put back together. A broken house can be put back together. And when I saw that, I began to think about his use of the word house. He used to say that his father repeated his stepfather over and over again, he quoting Joshua, his father was a Baptist minister, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And Jimmy was always fascinated by that. And if you know about the original title of his first novel, Go Tell It on the Mountain, it was called In My Father's House. And the first title for Notes of a Native Son is Me and My House. So the question of the house was always there for him. And the question in the film and the question in the book is, what is that house?
Right.
Is it the house he lived in Harlem, the apartment? It's partly that. Is it the house which is Harlem itself, in which he felt confined and in fact imprisoned by the prejudice which it reflects? Is it the National House?
Yes.
Is it the Eurocentric house which he finds himself living in? What is the house?
Right.
It's a crucial question.
Yes, that's a big question. The house of this house in which we all live, and what will happen to this house. Renee, I wanted to piggyback on something you mentioned. And just, I'm sure everyone, if you've been alive this past week, you've seen Raoul Peck being interviewed on Charlie Rose and everywhere. And I had the honor of meeting him this past Tuesday in DC, and he spoke, and he's, as he's spoken everywhere, about his 10-year journey to make this film. He said James Baldwin, of course, changed his life when he was 15 because he read him and discovered, and as so many people of color, African Americans in particular, he's Haitian American, or Haitian actually, but black men, black people, were given voice to something that they didn't know how to articulate. And as he says in the film, you know, you're not paranoid, you're not crazy, what you're experiencing is your reality, and it's really important to hear that. But so that's what Peck said, and he started this project 10 years ago, he said, because he felt that, you know, we were living in this post-racial, quote-unquote, fantasy, and he could see that it was not the truth, that we were paper overing things, and so he wanted to bring James Baldwin back to so people could understand that, and that is over the course of the 10 years, of course, the project became more and more painfully relevant. Those pictures of Trayvon Martin and Tamir Rice, and so how, what impact do you think this might have, this film? How should we use it? I don't know. Just what do you want to say about that?
There's this thread that runs, you know, for the last 50 years, you can probably go 50 years prior to that, in all the ways that we're continually told that as a nation we're falling short, and that we are denying opportunities, and we are oppressing people, and we are disenfranchising people. And somehow, we keep coming up with new ways to keep doing that. So, you know, there has been, you know, obviously, you know, these last few months, I don't know if you heard, but Donald Trump is president now. And I have this funny feeling that his election would not have surprised James Baldwin at all. I was shocked, because I didn't think America would do that to itself. But Baldwin, who described himself as an optimist, probably knew this was coming. Because over and over again, there were instances where this country could have been better and chose not to be. So I think that's, for me, what I kept coming back to in the film. You know, there's the moment where he's sort of juxtaposing images of Birmingham and Ferguson. And when Ferguson happened in 2014, everyone was just like, oh my God, this looks like, you know, Alabama in the 1960s. And my concern is that my godchildren, who are now all teenagers, will be having this conversation in 20 years and saying, oh wow, whatever atrocity is happening now looks just like Ferguson when I was a kid. It's this continuum. It's shocking to me the way this nation can't better itself. When everyone talked about post-racial America after the election of President Obama, I don't know many black people who went, oh yeah, we're post-racial now, that's all good. Nobody I knew believed that. And as a matter of fact, a lot of people I knew thought it was actually going to get worse, because there was going to be this, and it did, because there was going to be this incredible pushback to having this black man as the face of this nation. So, I mean, you know, I think that's what it was for me. I watched the film and just felt overwhelmingly sad. You know, I want to watch this. You know, I want to watch this film as if I'm watching a documentary about the California Gold Rush. You know, and oh my God, it's history, and look how much fun that was. And it's not that. It's happening today. You know, James Baldwin speaks to America today because America simply hasn't changed enough since Baldwin's time.
Quentin, do you want to jump in?
I'd add something. That was great. Just a little something that I would say on top of that, in terms of how to use it as a film and what kind of a film it is. I mean, one of the points it makes is that, and I forget Baldwin's exact language, but he's saying that there's two realities, and one is this subterranean reality, and the two never confront one another. So you see all these sort of, you know, silly movies, and then you see some really gruesome images, for instance, of lynching. And he's saying that these two realities have never been put in conversation with one another, that the problem all along has been a refusal to see, a refusal to confront, and especially in the movies. I mean, as we've already said, that Baldwin was a big film buff. He had a kind of ambiguous relationship with making movies, but you know, movies were part of his reality and part of our collective reality. So there had never been a confrontation on the screen, I'd say, until this moment, right? And what this movie does is to put those two realities, the surface reality or the superficial reality and the subterranean reality, white reality and the black reality, into direct conversation with one another. And what I noticed the first time I saw it, I was watching it alone, and it was very, very moving. But watching it in this crowd was even more moving, because Everyone was so quiet throughout the entire film, as a lot of us in here, until we all erupted in applause. And there was this kind of, you know, collective, very moving experience, I think, that happened. And for me, it was even more moving, of course, as it always is, seeing in a crowd. But I think it's partially because of that confrontation. This is, you know, something that we have to face. And that may be why we've never moved into the world that Baldwin envisioned.
I think precisely. Yeah, David, you want to jump in?
Yeah, I agree with that completely. And as a white person, I can't help but remember something that Baldwin said on a number of occasions. Several things, but the first one is, I'm only black because you think you're white. And that's something, you know, it says everything. And in a way, the film says that. Also, what he said often was, you can't have your history without me. You can't have your history without my history. And until you lose your innocence, innocence yes. was a favorite word of his, by which he meant your illusions, your failure to see, your obsession with some sort of psychic purity. Until that's overcome, we can never be free, any of us. Yes. And until you lose that, you won't be able to lose the horror that's in you because you're a racist.
Yes, I think you're right. Of course you are, you're a biographer, but I mean, one of the things that has always struck me most about James Baldwin is his naming that insistence on innocence, American innocence, right? Willful innocence, he calls it. And I thought Peck did a brilliant job of illustrating, right, that all that, you know, the colors and the people are dancing through the park. And I mean, that's just, that's that this illusion or delusion, this dream of an America that never existed. And that right now some people are trying to recall, and that's why we're in the shape we're in.
America great again.
Exactly. An America that was never great in that way in the first place. And I think Renee nailed it that if you read enough Baldwin, and I am curious, just out of curiosity, I would imagine most people, but how many people in here this would be their introduction to James Baldwin? Okay, so a reasonable number. And you guys are here on a Sunday on Patriots. So imagine the general American population, right, that this would be their introduction to James Baldwin, which is why this film is so incredibly important. I forgot my point, but let's move on. What else shall we talk about with James Baldwin? Renee, you were going to jump in with something?
I think one thing that the film didn't address, but which spoke to me when I first started reading Baldwin, was the fact that he was black and gay. And the first Baldwin book I read was Go Tell It on the Mountain. And of course, I read it because I knew the song, because I was raised in the church like he was, and I grew up in New York, and I was black, and I was dealing with a lot of issues around my sexuality. And suddenly, you know, James Baldwin was the first black gay person I was aware of. And even though he existed in book form, I didn't feel alone. You know, there would be other people later on, Audre Lorde and Barbara Smith, but James Baldwin was the first in sort of talking about what those issues meant in the ways that you felt alienated in your community, and then later on in the wider gay lesbian community.
Right.
So, you know, for me, that was extraordinarily important growing up, and in a lot of ways still is.
That's a really important point. I noted that too this time. I didn't notice it the first time, but it is interesting, and I would be curious to ask Peck why he didn't focus on that. Maybe, you know, but certainly Baldwin's utter fearlessness, or courage perhaps is a better word, because courage means you act despite fear, in being open about his homosexuality at a time when it was damaging to be so. I mean, Giovanni's Room was published in what year? Was, do you know? 56, right? Giovanni's Room, if you haven't read it, go read it, it's brilliant. David, do you want to talk about jump in there about that?
Yeah, it's interesting. Giovanni's Room, he said, was not a gay novel. It was a novel about the failure to recognize love.
Which is an American.
But obviously it was a gay novel too.
The first publisher rejected it, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
The publisher who had published Go Tunnel on the Mountain refused Giovanni's Room, that Knopf.
Right, Knopf.
Because they were afraid of it, basically.
They lived to regret that, I guess.
I could say that he would have said, I'm only gay because you think you're straight. And I think that is what he would have said.
Awesome. I
never heard him actually say that, but he would have said, what he did say often was, I've loved some women, I've loved some men, and what's important is the fact that I've loved. The fact that more of the people he loved physically were men than women indicates, I suppose, according to our way of seeing things, or the culture's way of seeing things, that he was gay or queer or whatever you want to call it. But he really did not much like being defined. In that sense, I suppose he'd be a little old-fashioned now. He didn't like being defined because he felt definition was being, would meant that he was being confined to a particular role or to a particular place in the vision of life.
Right.
I actually think that's very modernist, not
okay.
connected to labels. I mean, don't we hear that all the time now? It's like no one wants to be sort of shoved into one box. So actually he was progressive in that way.
He's gender fluid.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, and he and in the film, and I mean, he talks about the passage about being a witness and the necessity of being able to move freely. He's talking physically there in some cases to go into town when the civil rights movement and leave because he's serving a higher purpose, and sometimes that cost him. But the necessity of not being bound by any ideology or gender or race or nationality, right? And we know he spent most of his time back and forth between France, never giving up on America, but always having to flee, and Turkey also in other places, right? Quentin, do you want to jump in on that?
Yeah, I would just add, this might be taking us off track, and if so, I'm sorry, but you know, David mentioned the word love, and I every time I speak about Baldwin in public, I feel the need to emphasize that love was really at the center of Baldwin's message, that, you know, everything he did was an act of love. And I also want to say that his definition of love is not the same that most of our definitions are. He spoke in The Fire Next Time of love as quest and daring and growth. You know, and those were the words he used. And I think that love for him was a very active and not very passive emotion. It was, you know, you don't just fall in love. I think for Baldwin, love was just part of this sort of notion of an ongoing journey, which I really see his life as that, you know, quest and daring and growth. I'll repeat the words because I think that they're super important. So I don't think we can fully understand Baldwin without getting into that definition of love and expanding it.
Pete, that was one of his criticisms, is that Americans have a very sentimental, juvenile idea of love. He said love does not begin and end the way we think it does. Love is a battle, love is a war, love is a growing up. Not that I have James Baldwin memorized or anything, but yeah, so David, do you want to talk about his idea?
And it's messy.
And it's messy. It's messy and it's dirty, and you got to get in there.
But only by, remember in The Fire Next Time, he says, unless we few, the few white people and a few black people who can come together like lovers, and he italicized those words, like lovers.
Yes.
But he means the kind of love that Quentin is talking about, and the kind of love you're talking about that's hard work, that means compromise, that means letting your defenses down. I mean, this could be applied to actually love between two people. I think we know that. It means letting our defenses down. It means becoming vulnerable. And unless we can achieve that kind of love racially and culturally, there's no way we can overcome that innocence, which is so destructive.
Yes. I want to make sure we have time to bring the audience into the conversations.
There's a question that you must ask as a white person. How has white racism impacted me? And how does it continue to impact you? Because if we want to turn the corner, people like James Baldwin and all cannot turn the corner until white people address the fact that something had to happen to you at a very deep level that makes it difficult to turn the corner.
Thank you.
Can't do
Thank
it
you.
Without you. So that's my statement.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, while we're having other questions, maybe Quentin or David or Renee can talk about one of the things that's so powerful about James Baldwin, too, was his investigation of the white psyche.
I recently had a conversation with one of my best friends. We've known each other for 30 years. She's white. And we were sort of talking about, you know, Donald Trump and the whole thing, and she's actually decided she's had enough and she's gonna move to Canada. She doesn't wanna deal with it. And I said, well, that's great for you, but I'm staying, and I'm, if the Civil War is coming, I'm fighting. So, and she likened me to someone in an abusive relationship. And that America was my abuser, and somehow I had just been deluded into thinking things would get better. And my response was, you know, my family has been here for five generations. I ain't leaving. Why should I leave? I'm gonna stay here and fight for this country that has, for better or for worse, made me what I am. So I think that's the idea, that's sort of that part of it. But there is this other idea of, I don't know, I think as a black person, you're always sort of torn between, you know, wanting, you know, white people to recognize their issues, but also feeling like it is not my job to teach you. You gotta go out there and get it yourself. I think it has to be both in a funny kind of way. I think there are people who are not gonna pay attention unless you literally wave it in front of their face and say, racism isn't only my problem, and racism doesn't only affect me. And, you know, when you look at, you know, all the people who have been denied opportunities in this country, maybe one of those people had the cure for cancer. Maybe one of those people could have cured AIDS. Maybe one of those people would have written the great American novel that James Baldwin didn't write at some point. You know what I mean? Another great American novel, I should say. So, I mean, that's the thing. It's like, you know, racism reduces everyone. It's not just the people who are targeted. It's everyone. And I think that's part of what, at least what I was getting from the film, and the idea that there's a reason why what you do to me affects you.
Right.
I just have a question for those Baldwin scholars and those who knew him, what he might think about the deep racism that has perpetuated our foreign policy, particularly over the last 15 years. I think the ongoing destruction of brown bodies in the Middle East is part of our racist heritage, and the fact that it doesn't sort of hit the American psyche over and over again as people are killed in Yemen and Iraq, Afghanistan, how would he make sense of that sort of global dynamic of racism?
Just as he would say that the problem in America is not limited to any one group, I think he would suggest that the American problem becomes a kind of global problem, or is more, and he, so he was constantly making connections that way. I brought up the essay, No Name in the Street, before. It's really about that. Mm-hmm. It's really about kind of making sense of our position in the world and what we're doing to destroy not only our nation but to bring everything down with it. So I think that he was ahead of his time on that, as he was on many many issues. A prophet, a lot of people speak of him as.
I think a lot of us here are watching this from the perspective of the Trump revolution. I was pleased to hear in a way that the movie was not made with that in mind, really. It was made to see the whole picture as it's been going on, you know, all right. these years. Right. But in a way, living right now in the Trump era, I'm feeling that same despair again as the end of the 60s.
Right.
But I do think this was a film that primarily took place in the 60s and evokes that very much for me.
Right. Well, I think that's, ironically, perhaps a good last comment from you, because, of course, James Baldwin, even though he was accused, especially towards the end of his life, of being bitter, right, repeatedly, and anybody who speaks the truth about race in this country is always accused of being bitter, but whatever. And yet he was never bitter. Maya Angelou in The Price of the Ticket talking said that he was angry, but he was never bitter. And he refused to give in to despair. So what would he leave us with in this moment of the person's name who shall not be named? Quentin.
I would direct everyone if some people said they hadn't read Baldwin, I think actually a great starting point is the essay Notes of a Native Son, in which he's talking about four things that are happening simultaneously. His father's funeral, his own 19th birthday, the birth of his youngest sibling, and the Harlem riots of 1943, all happening at the same time. So this kind of perfect storm, this confluence. And the word bitterness comes up over and over in that. And he's talking about his father and saw bitterness in his father and refuses to let that bitterness become his. There's a lot of metaphors in the essay about disease and, you know, the kind of infection in his blood and all of this stuff that's inside him. And that's what I associate with bitterness, especially in the distinction that you're making between anger and bitterness. Bitterness is something that eats away at you. Anger is something that can be released. So I think that going back to that essay and thinking through that idea, don't let it eat away and find some productive way to release it.
Yes, thank you. David.
No, I would agree with that completely. He teaches us that we can't love unless we look at a person, see a person, hear a person, not see or hear a category.
I think what struck me was at the end of the film when he says that he does not think of himself as a pessimist, that he's an optimist. So I think I'm going to try optimism for 2017. Because I'm a native New Yorker and my tendency is to be bitter. However, optimism doesn't mean you don't fight back. It doesn't mean you don't resist. It doesn't mean that you become a doormat. It simply means that you can still see the way to a better day. And so that's what I'm hoping for.
Thank you so much to our panelists, and thank you to Raoul Peck, and thank you to James Baldwin.